and I'm not here to talk about anything as nice and elaborate as the city center, I'm here to talk about sewage. Yes! Show the excitement.
We want to be there.
As we talked about at the last meeting about capacity and different things we can do with capacity and so on and so forth, is that went back and put together some numbers, as I told you guys at the last council meeting, that I would be here to give you some more numbers, and probably gonna go with a lot more numbers at you than you're gonna hear about, but we'll get down and nail it on the head at the end, and that's the main thing you're gonna concern yourself with. Basically, the sludge blanket that we talked about last time, we talked about dredging the pond and different things like that. Your sludge blanket currently is roughly about 2.5 feet, some places about 3.5 feet. Now, that calculates to 2 million gallons of sludge. So once that pond is dredged and you remove 2 million gallons of sludge, you provide a spot for 2 million gallons of water. Now, what does that mean? That does not mean that input still equals output, but what that does mean is that gives you detention time. It gives you 2 million gallons worth of detention time, which calculates on your average flow to about 10 days of detention time. What we're talking about when we're talking about 10 days of detention time is, in the end, you're talking about cleaner treatment that comes out the backside of the pond. As well as it gives you an opportunity, based upon permit in the winter months, the wet months, you're allowed to discharge 475,000 gallons per day. We can draw down during that time. Your average flow is about 180,000 gallons a day. Your max flow is running about 326. Now, when we have the 475,000 during the winter, no problem even on the max side. Where the problem comes is in the summer months, you're allowed to discharge at Sprayfield 310,000 gallons. So, in a nutshell, what we can do by reducing the amount of sludge, provide some capacity, we can draw it down, give us 10 days of storage, detention time, whatever you want to call it, try to draw that down during the winter, allow you some room during the summer. Now, is this an end-all fix? No, it's not. There is other things that's going to have to be looked at down the road. But what we can do is create a better treatment coming out of the backside of the pond prior to the wet. Your violations have mostly been ammonia violations coming out of the back of the wet. Basically, you put in cleaner water in front of the wetland, in theory, you get cleaner water on the backside of the wetland. Now, there's some contributing factors to that as far as the vegetation in the wetland. I spoke to Donnie earlier about burning the wetlands, but it never really goes dormant, so you don't have the opportunity to burn it. So that's some issues that we may have to deal with. Having said all that, what we can then do is petition EPD, because we have cleaner water. We can petition EPD to potentially increase the discharge limit. They can help us through them summer months when the water's not flowing and we have to go to Sprayfield. If we can petition them to increase that discharge amount because it is cleaner, if they grant that and we could at least get to the 326, which is your max flow, which we are reducing through the IMI process and so on and so forth, then we're out of the woods, so to speak. But in the interim, dredging the pond allows us, again, that detention time, that storage area that we can potentially draw down when we're allowed to discharge virtually based upon incoming flows. You could say we can discharge as much as we want because we can discharge 475. The rough estimate cost that we come up with to remove the sludge blanket that exists is based upon a project that we did last year. A company out of Alabama did it, and they got a permit, a special permit, to land apply the sludge in Alabama. Now, I'm not telling you that can happen again, but it could. But they gave us a very good price. Based upon that price, the amount of sludge we would need to remove would cost you about $300,000. And I think whenever we were just throwing rough figures at it the other day, we would run around $400, $450, something like that today. So that if we, you know, if that company comes in, they can land apply, that reduces your cost, you know, from that area. But still, we may be looking at 400 400 or so, but 300 is about the target area that we're estimating at this point, like I say, based upon the amount of sludge that's in the pond.
So just to tag along to what the engineer talked about, we have a couple of projects, not including the sludge plant yet, that are on tap right now, that are in various phases of completion, one of which we had a pre-construction conference on earlier today for inflow and infiltration improvements. This has become an annual event, so to speak, where we are doing slip line construction and, where needed, manhole rehabilitation to reduce the amount of water coming into the system during heavy rains. So when we do that, when we reduce the heavy rains that come into the system, we then reduce the amount, as he said, of treated or water that has to be treated. So that is an ongoing process. The other project is a main lift station constructed right next to the present one that is currently in the process of design. And what we have then are two projects that are yet to be constructed, so to speak, that would need funding, potentially. One would be the main lift station construction, which was discussed at the retreat. It was also discussed at the subsequent council meeting. Y'all gave the go-ahead for that. The estimated cost is around $200,000. And also, the sludge blanket removal, which we're hoping will be $300,000, but could be somewhere in the neighborhood of $500,000, worst-case scenario. So if you combine the two projects, you then have perhaps not something that we would fund out of special purpose local option sales tax, though it would be eligible. You would have potentially a better use of funding through an option that was presented to the council a few years ago when we wanted to do a similar project of size and scope. In this particular instance, the engineer had recommended, and the council concurred, with improving the city's supply of fresh water. We then constructed deep well number 3 out on the west side of town for the approximate cost of $500,000. Well, the interest rate we got was around 1% from the Georgia Environmental Facilities Authority for 20 years, which was a super rate at a super price, and we were able to extend out the financing of it and be able to use the operating capital for other sources. So I'm getting to my point here. When the council raised rates 2 years ago for the purposes of not only funding existing obligations, there was a mind out there and an ear kept to the tracks of funding depreciation. So depreciation is the continual degradation of value in your system. It decreases by a little bit every year because it gets older every year. And we place that figure somewhere in the neighborhood of $200,000 to $250,000. So the value of the system decreases every year, but depreciation in your audit is treated as a cash expense. We all went a long way to funding depreciation when you approved the $13 increase. And in fact, when the auditor came and presented last month, we had thereabouts a $70,000, for lack of a better term, profit above and beyond expenses that could be used to fund depreciation. It wasn't a profit by an accounting sense because depreciation was not completely funded. However, it was a cash positive, and that is available funding for only a partial phased increase that would be able to be used for additional debt service. So we estimate this year, with a fully funded $13, it was phased last year, you would be able to realize somewhere in the neighborhood of $140,000 to $150,000. Again, not completely funding depreciation, but having a cash positive, thereby you could use for the entire purpose of funding depreciation, which is the improvement of the system. And that's what it was created to do, is to have cash to be able to improve the overall capital needs of the system. So what I'm getting to is, should the council desire, the engineer and I, over the past took a walk over with Councilman Davis to the Georgia Environmental Facilities Authority booth, and we talked with their staff there, and floated this figure of around $500,000, worst case scenario, for the sludge line removal, and a couple of $100,000 for the lift station construction, and asked for their recommendations. They stated that the program matched up very well with the Clean Water State Revolving Fund. Now, the Clean Water State Revolving Fund is a federal program, but one in which the current rates right now are around 1.89% for up to 20 years. So if you wanted to finance this project, you can get a great rate of 1.89%, run out for 20 years, for an amortization schedule of an annual cost of right at about $45,000. And here again, that is worst case scenario. We plugged in a number of $750,000. So if a total project cost of $750,000 was financed, you would have, worst case scenario, financed an annual debt service of $45,000 annually. That is versus $750,000 financed out of pocket in the SLOT fund. I would very much recommend being able to use money for SLOT, not just for water sewer, but for other projects that have been discussed, and being able to lay it back for other priorities that will come before the council, should this opportunity present itself, and I think it has. So if the council were willing to consider applying for this indebtedness, I think it would be a very wise use of the city's funding. And I think when we submit our credit availability to GEPA, that looking and seeing the steps the council has taken, they will finance the city for some similar amount. But we wanted to bring this before you, entertain any questions you may have, see what you thought, and just kind of get your overall deal for it.
Well, we're talking about two different issues, really. One, we're talking about the project itself, and then we're talking about financing, correct?
Correct.
Really, that's two different issues we're talking about tonight. Correct?
Correct.
And technically three, if you're talking about the sludge dredging.
Right.
And a potential, well, it's already been funded, it's already been passed to buy a, or build a structure from the lift station, from the pump station. And then the third issue would be how you're going to finance it. Okay, I just want to get that straight.
Yes, absolutely. That is correct. I know that Councilman Barker is not here tonight. I have had an opportunity to talk with him as well. He was in attendance at the conference for a brief period of time. He also had an opportunity to review these materials. Did not have any specific questions, but offered his support for whatever the council chose to do in that regard. But like I said, if you were to consider the financing option, I think you would be able to free up SLOST to be able to fund a lot more different priorities over this year and next, rather than apply all of it to water sewer, which I think is the alternative. Based on receipts and how the special purpose local option sales tax tank has been, with the obligation of sludge blanket removal and lift station construction, paying all of that out of pocket is probably going to obligate SLOST for the next year at least, maybe even up to 16 months.
At the completion of the sludge blanket, in my mind, it's a different thing. I thought that was some sort of piece of equipment, but I assume now it's just a sludge that's in the pond, right?
When the sewage comes in, it breaks down and it creates sludge on the bottom of it.
That's just the system we have, right?
Picture it as an upside down septic tank. If you ever looked in a septic tank, you get a sludge blanket on top of a septic tank. Just turn it over. The sludge blanket is on the bottom, and it's just the broken down sewage and that type of thing.
Well, that's not going to get you better, right?
No, it only works from here.
Yeah. is a request, a necessity, that this is, I mean, this needs to be done, right?
Yes, yes, it definitely needs to be done, if for no other reason. If capacity wasn't even anything we're discussing, to help reduce the ammonia violations.
Yeah, yeah. EPD compliance, this is going to help us bring us back in line.
That's correct, that's correct.
Right.
Now, was there not a recommendation back in early 2000s about dredging this pond back then?
Yes, there was. We had talked about it, somewhere in the early 2000s, we had talked about dredging the pond at that time. And I think at that time, the sludge blanket was, I think it was about 2 foot then. So since early 2000, we've raised another half foot.
This is 25 years of accumulation.
Yes, yes.
Which displaces how much of the capacity of the pond?
2 million gallons.
2 million gallons. So because of this 2.5 foot sludge blanket at the bottom of the pond, it is reducing the storage capacity by 2 million gallons.
What it is reducing mainly is going to be your detention time. Because you are reducing that 2 million gallons worth, which puts your water from point A to point B faster.
Right.
And the detention time is what cleans your water.
Right.
Although it produces more sludge, that's what cleans your water. So you would have to have that.
The ability to hold 2 million, whatever term you're using,
right.
2 million gallons more in the pond, during which time you have more time to treat.
That's correct.
And displace flow from that point forward, reducing ammonia, and therefore reducing future potential infractions, state infractions.
That is correct. Basically, the water that hits it today, 10 days later, is when it's going to come out the backside of that pond.
Today.
Right. So you have, from today, 10 days, is when it discharges.
You remove the 2.5 sludge blanket.
No, that's what, once we remove, that 2 million gallons calculates to
10 days. 10 more days.
Right.
Additional to what we have now.
That's correct.
Okay.
Which just cleans you up more over that 10-day period.
Right.
So they handle the ammonia and the virus that you're talking about.
Right. Basically, the dirtier the water you put in front of the wetland, the harder the wetland has to clean it up, which is not happening all the time. It happens for the most part.
Right.
But you have had some ammonia violations.
It happens as long as you can hold it long enough and you don't get a flood to come in and
That's correct.
Blow it out before it's ready.
That's correct.
What I'm saying on the capacity side, what we have during this war is freeing up. I know we have a certain amount of capacity.
Right.
What would that do to the capacity?
What that frees up in the capacity again is based upon what we can get through EPD by being able to present them. Not only have you reduced your inflow and infiltration, you have dredged the pond, you're producing cleaner water, you've avoided the ammonia violations. We petitioned for a permit adjustment for the summer months. That's the only months we're talking about, is the summer months on capacity. Again, if through our I&I projects that go on, if we can reduce 16,000 gallons of water on your max flow, you're in permit even in the summer months. Because you're permitting 310 and you're discharging max 326. So we're 16,000 gallons different. So anyway, if that's the one we want to try and increase is the discharge to the spray feature.
I guess what I'm looking at as far as if we wanted to damage the surface for houses or communities, what detriment would you do? I mean, I got a number in my head, but I don't want to say anything.
Per person, I think is what you're talking about.
Okay. If we can reduce that sludge, like if we can get that detention time, again, we're at the mercy of EPD, but you take that pond back to where it originally was, and you're talking about 2 million gallons,
right.
And you're talking roughly 100 to 120 gallons per person per day.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, that's where I'm at.
I mean, I didn't want to think that was...
Right. Now, again, to add to that, our bottleneck, if you will, is the spray feed. That is our bottleneck. In the winter months, we have no issues.
other than the ammonia violations and that type of thing that we need to clean up as far as what we can put out of that pump. The summer months is the one that we're most concerned with. And that's where we would have to go back and try to modify that permit. If we couldn't modify that permit, then we got to talk about, do we expand the spray field? Can we somehow find a way to discharge more, or longer, I guess I should say, to the creek as far as...
But just increasing the storage capacity alone, I mean, to be able to hold the water, I mean, would be infinitely preferable, you know, to...
Yes, absolutely. Because we can draw down, because now you can produce cleaner water, you can avoid the ammonia issues, you can put more water out during your winter months when you have no, like say, your permit for 475, your max is 360. So we can draw it down at that point to create the storage capacity, again, because now we have cleaner water that can get us through them summer months.
There are periods in the summer months, and Donnie can talk about this, where we've drawn it as far as it can go. And the potential here is that there's even more that could be drawn down mm-hmm. if the sludge blanket were removed mm-hmm. to be able to increase capacity up for additional rainy seasons or what have you. So that whole summer bottleneck really goes away. I mean, you have an opportunity to be able to significantly increase the capacity of the city during those summer months through this decision. So,
with the pond, basically what you have is a clear zone. And that clear zone is where you want to discharge from. You don't want to get into your sludge blanket, but you don't want to get on the top either, so you want to be in that clear zone. So if your clear zone's here, you fill up the pond 2 feet, now your clear zone's here. So that you follow where I'm going with that, you have very much limited your area that you can draw decent discharge water. So John, when we draw it down now, you draw it down, you got that clear zone is much larger because you've eliminated 2.5 feet that's used up by sludge. So. Bottom line is it's a project that needs to be done, even if, like I said earlier, even if capacity wasn't an issue, just to eliminate the ammonia violations and different things like that. And what you get for it is, I know when we talk about $300,000 is a lot of money, but the benefit, $300,000 is really not that much money when you start talking about expanding the treatment plan, you start talking about things like that to accomplish it.
Or entertaining additional subdivisions or commercial developments. I really think this will be able to permit everyone to sort of rest their mind, I guess, with respect to the whole capacity issue. Not that I don't think one exists right now, but even if it did, I think the removal of the sludge blanket would go a tremendous way to be really able to put those issues to rest.
Yeah.
So really what we're looking for is just some direction from the council as to what y'all would like to do. Obviously, as Councilman Davis has pointed out, the lift station construction has already been decided. That project is in design. If you did want to entertain the sludge blanket removal, the method for which to finance and the potential to add on lift station construction to that total package, we can put the application in and see if it's something that the city wants to entertain. We can withhold final approval until we get an approval back from GECO, if that's what you would like as well. So I think there are a lot of options that are out there for the council to be able to consider. Or if you'd like to let it sit and marinate for another month and just kind of like think about it a little bit, we just sort of wanted to get this in front of you as soon as possible so you could be aware.
I think the idea of the sludge blanket removal is something that we know was, I didn't know this before, but do now, that it was proposed a year ago?
Still more than 10.
And to have removed it at that time would have been about half. I can only guess at that, but I think there was actually a number back in the paperwork. come from that number. The cost was about half, something by your explanation and by my understanding is something that's going to need to be done inevitably at some point in the future anyway. So the need, in my mind, is there. So if the need is there and we're going to move on and do it, and I'm not saying we need to hurry with this by any means, I'm open to however long you guys want to discuss this, but I'm just giving my opinion that I think is needed. If we are going to do it, if we do ultimately decide to do it, I think you can't do a whole lot better than to get half a million to three quarters of $1 million loan at 1.89%. Did I get that number correct?
Yes.
1.89% for 20 years. As the city manager mentioned, a $500,000 Jeepa loan that was, or $1 million Jeepa loan?
About $470,000.
$470,000, this is another thing to think about. $470,000 Jeepa loan was taken out 10 years ago or so, and we just refinanced that 2 years ago. So that shows you don't know what the economic landscape looks like, because at some point, as was the case at a 1% interest rate, we're able to come back 10 years later, refinance and say, over $500,000 of interest that I remember as we were discussing it from refinancing over the next 15 years. So if we were to do this, who knows what the landscape would look like over the next 10 to 15 years on a 20-year loan. We may be able to do that again and get that interest rate down in half. That's a fixed rate, so the worst we're doing is 1.89%. And it is possible in a 10 to 15-year period you could cut that even lower. Those are my thoughts. No conclusions, but those are my thoughts. I think it's a good idea to do it, and I think it's a good idea if we're going to do it to borrow the money rather than deplete our SPLOST figures, as the city manager explained. And those are my thoughts on it.
I agree as well. I think we should look into the financing option for John.
Okay, so we'll put that on the I guess just to check your opinion.
Well, if you'd like, we actually utilized our engineer staff for the preparation of that application for, so they're very well versed in how to do that. If they could assist us with the preparation of it again, we will run it up the flagpole and see if their underwriter salute, and we'll come back to you with notifications to how they feel. You might authorize
this to be. And Jonathan, correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe when we was at Jeepless, we were talking to them, it was September is the next meeting.
Yes, the new rates take effect in August, and I believe the next loan round is September. So I'm sure we'll be able to have cost estimate and project information ready by then. His staff's very used to working with us, so we can get all that together and make sure that we get a good package.
Okay. All right. Any more questions for Robert? Thank you very much, Robert. Thank you. Public Safety Administration, spread the sound, requests.